Joining us now on the debate for the full hour tonight in New York City, Glenn Lowry, director of the MoMA, the Museum of Modern Art. In Columbus, Ohio, Stephen Conn, professor of history at The Ohio State University and the author of Do Museums Still Need Objects? And with us here in studio, Janet Carding, director and CEO of the ROM, the Royal Ontario Museum, Jay Robinson, Toronto City Councillor for Ward 25, that's Don Valley West, and Caitlin Kelly, freelance journalist and author, originally from Toronto, but now calls New York home. It's good to have everybody both around this table and in Points Beyond for our discussion tonight. I'm going to encourage everybody but Stephen at the moment to relax. Sit back, because Stephen, I'm going to start with you for the first several minutes here, just because you've got a book out on this, and we're curious as to what you think classifies as a museum. Before we consider whether museums still matter, let's figure out and make sure we all agree on what is a museum. Tell us.
That's a really tricky question. It seems straightforward, but in fact, I think the definition of what constitutes a museum has expanded dramatically over the last, let's call it, generation. I think 100 years ago, it was a pretty straightforward proposition. Museums were places of collections, and they were divided up into a set of categories. Nowadays, a museum might not have a collection at all. Museums have divided up audiences. We have children's museums now. They've divided up the world of science into different categories. So I think museums are, in some sense, whatever people choose to call them nowadays.
Well, tell me this. We've got something up here in the northwest part of Toronto called Black Creek Pioneer Village. It's, I guess, a junior example of what you in the States might refer to as, you know, Williamsburg, Virginia, same kind of thing. Is that a museum?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a very good question. Those living history, the way costumed reenactors where people dress up and they cook a lot of food over wood stoves and whatnot, they actually go back quite a long ways to the 19th century. Are they a museum? I would call them a museum, but they certainly function differently than, say, the MoMA. You don't see a lot of wood smoke in the galleries at the MoMA. But I do think they would count as, nowadays, as something we consider part of the landscape of our museums.
If you see wood smoke at the MoMA, it is a catastrophe, I'm guessing, right?
Exactly.
Quite right.
Glenn is saying quite right. Okay. Let me do a little quote from your book here, Do Museums Still Need Objects, Steve, and then I'll get you to comment on the question. We live in a museum age. At the turn of the 21st century, more people are going to more museums than at any time in the past. And simultaneously, more scholars, critics, and others are writing and talking about museums. The two phenomena are almost certainly related, but it doesn't seem to be a happy relationship. Why not?
Yeah, I think that's a somewhat sharp observation that I was making, but I think it is surely the case that over, again, let's roughly call it the last generation, there has been this tremendous proliferation of new institutions, of the expansion of older institutions. It really has been, in some ways, a second golden age of museum building. And at the same time, that proliferation of institution building has generated a tremendous amount of new scholarship, of newspaper columns, much of which has been of the sort of hand-wringing variety. There seems to be an uneasiness about this proliferation of museum and related cultural institutions. And I was interested in why it is that on the one hand, museums seem to be thriving, but on the other hand, a lot of people who write about them seem pretty unhappy with what's going on.
Now, we've got a pretty good idea nowadays about what museums are for. But a few centuries ago, when they were built for the first time, what were they for back then?
I think that the impulse to collect is as old as we can figure out how old it is. What the modern museum, I think, really has its origins in the royal collections, in the cabinets of curiosity that go back really to the, let's call it the Enlightenment, the 17th and the 18th century. And I think they served a couple of purposes. On the one hand, they satisfied that impulse to collect. On another level, they served as display for the taste, the erudition, and the wealth of the people who could collect. When nations got into the museum building business, especially in the 19th century, they were projects of nationalism, that these collections represented the ascendancy of great powers. And the collections themselves represented the fruits of empire. I think by the end of the 19th century, increasingly these museums were seen as educational vehicles, as a way of reaching large audiences in ways that were not possible through formal school institutions. And I think this is particularly true in the United States, and I apologize for my U.S. focus here. But I think by the turn of the 20th century, education became a central piece of what museums were for.
Don't apologize for the U.S. stuff. We got lots of Canadian content on this program, too, including Mr. Lowry. I'm going to you right now because you spent a lot of your career up here as well. And I want to just follow up with that impulse to collect and ask you this. Do you think museums begin with a collection or do they begin with a physical space?
I actually don't think they begin with either. I think most great museums begin with an idea that then has to manifest itself through a collection of objects that also require ultimately a physical space in which to be viewed. So the issue isn't object or building, but idea. And when you talk about museums, you have to understand that they have a long history of exploring complex ideas, whether they are about courtly issues or about how to classify the world or how to look at an individual artist. And those ideas are potent, and the potency of the ideas gives rise to the shape of a collection. No collection, of course, can be greater than the works of art themselves. So when we talk about buildings, of course, it's great to have a fabulous building, and many museums have extraordinary buildings. But the buildings, in a sense, are simply the space in which those objects and ideas engage with each other.
Mind you, Caitlin, some of the buildings lately have become so beautiful in themselves,
right. They're
as much an attraction on the outside as the stuff that's inside. Isn't that fair to say?
Well, it depends on the building. I mean, we know that there are controversial buildings, but yes, that's true. I admit that I don't go to the Whitney very often because I really find it a horrible building. And then there are other buildings that you say, I really want to go inside. It's inviting you to go in. Although I have to admit, it's the older ones that I enjoy. I like the Guggenheim, and I really like the Hirshhorn, and they're round. There's a nice organic quality to them.
Anything outside New York you like?
Let me think. Yes, many things I like. I love the ROM. I really enjoy going to
the
ROM. There you go. I like the Gardner very much, actually. But yes, I think it can be an attraction for people who are perhaps not always inherently excited by the museum itself. If the architecture is inviting and it's exciting and it's been written about and it has with Alicia and Crystal, people say, I want to go check that out. I want to go see what's happening. So in some ways, I think it's really an interesting way to pull a new audience into the space. Yeah.
Just the Hirshhorn's in Washington, I know,
right.
But you
are,
you're in that triangle. Go ahead, Steve, you wanted to jump in on that?
Yeah, I think one of the things that's been interesting, if we looked at this over the last 50 and 100 years, is that the museums, the grand museums that got built 100 years ago, all looked remarkably the same. They were all variations, most of them, on neoclassicism of one kind or another. What's happened in the last 50 or odd years has been exactly the opposite. Museums always, in their new buildings, striving to be different than every other museum that you've ever been to. And so in that sense, I think the idea that Glenn talked about in certain cases is the idea of having a museum itself. I think that's been particularly true in areas which are counting on new museums to revive an economy or to attract tourists, but that the building in some ways has become at least as important as what goes on inside the building.
Janet, let me get you to follow up on that, because you're in charge of one of those buildings that, as a building, has just captured a great deal of imagination and controversy as well. What do you think?
Well, the Michael Leach and Crystal has been controversial, but what it's done for the ROM is, I think, it's at a stroke removed a problem that I think quite a few museums have, and that's that over time they've become to be perceived as static and somewhat out of date. And so I think Steve's right in terms of that trend in building, and I think it's been an attempt by museums to show that they're relevant and that they're here for today and that they're contemporary. And I think the Michael Leach and Crystal does that.
I don't know if you can do this, but when you think of your job, do you think of yourself primarily as the person in charge of what's inside the building or the building?
I actually think of myself as in charge of what's inside the building and the building and the community engagement around the building and the museum. And I think increasingly we're all spending a lot more time thinking, how do we make sure that our buildings and our collections and our museums are really plugged in and at the center of the community? And I've got a great start with the ROM, because the ROM, I haven't come across a museum like the ROM in my career that when I go and tell people that I'm the director of the ROM, they instantly respond by telling me the story that the first time they came, by telling me how important it is for the community. Mm-hmm. People tell me stories about visiting the ROM as a child and coming in and seeing the totem poles, and they've remained with them their whole life. And so I think that that's something that I see myself as shepherding. Part of my job is to make sure that successive generations feel the same way about the ROM, and I don't think we can take for granted that you use the methods of the past to do that in the future. That's what's changing.
That takes me to Jay, because it's funny, we pay a lot of lip service to how much we love our cultural institutions, and yet there is almost always this constant fear in the air that certainly governments are going to cut their budgets and force them into some kind of, I don't know, hibernation or extinction or whatever. And we just saw it with, you know, four here in the city of Toronto, which at least the fear was there that they were somehow going to be under threat. If we love our cultural institutions so much, why do they constantly seem threatened?
Well, this is interesting, this exercise we've just gone through, and thankfully we've saved them in this budget cycle. But when I asked people, what are the top 10 city-owned museums in Toronto, people couldn't name them. And I think it comes down to marketing and cross-promotion. Unfortunately, Toronto tends to act often in silos and can be a bit divisive. And I think if we really work together as a city and engaged on our heritage front and profiling heritage as part of arts and culture, I think it would be a lot more effective. So it's about underperforming museums. These are smaller museums in Toronto that are underperforming, and it's about getting heads through the doors and being a little bit more, as Janet just indicated, interactive and telling our stories through these facilities.
So let's be clear here. Art Gallery of Ontario doesn't count. Science Centre doesn't count. ROM doesn't count. Top 10 Toronto-owned, city-owned?
City-owned,
for example,
Gibson House up in North York, or Montgomery's Inn, which is in Etobicoke. And these are really old heritage facilities that tell our history, but making them more relevant to newcomers to Canada by engaging them in heritage, their heritage, and our heritage, and bringing our stories together. So there's an example in the Toronto Heritage website. There's an example of an old coffee urn, and people can connect, even though that's from Britain, it was a Britain specimen, people can connect to that through their stories.
Glenn, we hear a great deal about the museum as economic engine for the city in which they're built. Now, for the people who run museums, galleries, and so on, do you like or do you hate being referred to that way?
No, I don't mind being referred to that way at all. I mean, we are part of a community, and if we play a beneficial role by attracting tourism and causing people to spend income that helps generate sales tax and that helps keep our communities vibrant and alive, that's a wonderful byproduct of what we do. It's certainly not central. It's not the reason we exist. But we're also all very conscious of the fact that we're woven into the fabric of society, and as such, we have a role to play in that respect. The reality, though, is most museums are actually quite fragile. They may be economically beneficial to the communities in which they exist, but they're extremely expensive operations to maintain, and they're operations that always rely on some form of either government intervention or private philanthropy, because they're not self-sustaining without that.
Steve, I get the impression, though, and I'm sure Jay is an exception to this rule, that if you're a gallery or a museum and you're going to a politician asking them for support, you better be making the economic argument, because the argument that, well, listen, this will speak to people's souls, is going to fall flat off the table. Fair to say?
Yeah. I think that's absolutely right. And in the United States, that really does come down to two metrics. One is dollars, and the other is heads through the door. And that becomes a pretty crude way, I think, of measuring the value of a museum in terms of its mission and also in terms of its value. But I think that's the argument that people respond to and they expect you to make. I think it's a tricky question because there are a tremendous number of museums. Most of them are not the Royal Ontario Museum. Most of them are small house museums in small places that that really may not be able to afford to keep these places open. And so I think we are going to face some pretty difficult choices in the coming generation about how do we sustain these places and what happens when we decide, and I want to come back to Glenn's observation a moment ago, when the intellectual rationale for these places ceases to exist or ceases to persuade, how do we close them? How do we decide that it's time for some institutions to be finished?
That's a great question.
I'd love to jump in there because, I mean, I think the 20th century, as Stephen was saying, was a century of museum creation across actually large parts of the world, but certainly in North America. We saw this enormous explosion either in new museums or the growth of existing museums. But there's nothing preordained that says any of us can or should survive ad infinitum. But what we don't have in the cultural world is a mechanism by which to cease to exist. Companies are created and fail all the time, but we think of it as a tragedy when a cultural institution fails. And of course, it is a tragedy within the community, but we have failed to create the kind of sustained dialogue that can, in a sense, put in context the rationale for why some institutions will succeed and can succeed, and the rationale by which others may have been created at a certain moment in time, but the need for that institution has passed.
It does feel different, though, Caitlin, doesn't it? When you close a museum as opposed to when you're closing anything else, pick whatever manufacturing sector you want.
But right.
There is something different about a museum, isn't there?
Well, absolutely. I mean, it was funny. I wrote last year about the closing of all things very culturally valuable, the Liberace Museum.
I read that piece.
In Las Vegas. And I went to the Liberace Museum. And I have to tell you, for those who are in any way cynical about Liberace, who played the piano and had ridiculous rhinestone costumes, it was actually very moving and kind of sad to see that this collection of extraordinary objects, there were beautiful harpsichords and pianos.
Candelabras, of course.
Candelabras, some great jewelry. but nobody was going. The heads were not coming through the door. It had passed its time. And yet what I didn't know, and this is something I feel passionate about, there was no connection between the objects and the man. Once I was through the door to write an article, not because I would have gone as a tourist, there was a Liberace Foundation, and the man had given millions to young artists. So I think the larger issue is, to continue the dialogue, you've got to have some real sense of passionate connection to the people, in fact, behind the objects. And I don't know that that's easy to do, but I think that might have saved it. If people had said, this guy is really doing amazing things today for artists around America, I didn't know that before. That was a shame.
But Jay, if I remember the numbers in your piece, their attendance was off 90% from its high in the 70s. No museum's going to survive if their attendance drops 90%.
Sure.
So when you think about that top 10 list of museums in Toronto, how do you know when it's time to shut one of them down because people just aren't going there anymore?
Well, there's no doubt, as you said, we have to be competitive. But I think there's ways to approach it that we can actually make them more viable and vibrant. And like I said earlier, the cross-promotion, really working together as a city with all our urban spaces, our museums, arts and culture, and getting them back, getting heritage to be topical again and interesting, and really embedding it into the curriculum at the grade 5, grade 6 level, at the formative age where kids go and visit museums. A lot of that's happening already, but we need to have more of it and get kids across the whole city, the whole spectrum of heritage opportunities and institutions in the city, and experiencing those.
Janet, you wanted to add?
Yes, I just wanted to throw in that I think that there is still a real interest in museums, and I think the marketing is obviously very important, but I think what people are looking for is a place where they can go where there is a level of authenticity and there's a level of credibility. People are deluged with information from all different sources now, but they're looking for a place where if they go there, there's an opportunity for reflection, there's an opportunity for contemplation, but also importantly that they can speak to the people behind the collections, that they can understand more about them. Whenever we talk to our visitors at the ROM, and we're doing that more and more, number one question is, can we talk to one of the curators? Because we have questions about these things.
Absolutely.
We want to hear more about the stories. We want to hear more about what happens behind the scenes. So I'm not seeing a tailing off in interest. What I'm seeing is that people actually want more involvement.
And how they don't do you deal with that at the ROM?
Well, what we're doing at the ROM is that we're really thinking about how we can move from a situation where a million people come through the door and they, broadly speaking, have the same experience, to over time moving to a situation where actually it can be a personalized experience, that you can opt into the things that you're interested in, that you can find out more and go deeper in some areas. And technology is one of the ways that we're doing that. And we've been hugely helped along by the challenge that we're all having now, which is that everybody brings an encyclopedia to the museum in their own pocket. That didn't used to happen, and that's a big change for us.
Glenn, I wonder whether you're facing the same challenge insofar as when people come to your gallery, they want a more personal experience than the vast general experience they may have been accustomed to in the past.
I think that's for sure true, and I think most museums are doing an increasingly better job at engaging people. What we are very conscious of is the fact that people come to be in the museum not just to look at art, but to be with other people. It's a profoundly social experience. And the museums that I think have been the most successful, certainly in the last couple of decades, have been the institutions that have recognized that that social dynamic is essential to into creating the kind of engagement that we all want between people and objects. And this is where technology really can come into play, because it can provide the means for people to communicate with each other while they're in the museum and then outside the museum, so that there can be ongoing conversations. And then those conversations break down into highly personal relationships between people and works of art that they find interesting. And this sense of the museum as a place of engagement, actually a kind of crucible in which feelings and ideas are forged between different people and works of art, I think is what makes our museums today so exciting. And it's only technology that has allowed this kind of excitement to become very real, because you can access information discreetly, you can connect to people discreetly, and you can keep these conversations going discreetly, and thus each person can begin to shape the way he or she wants to relate, not only to the institution, but to other people interested in similar issues at the institution.
Let me do a fast follow-up with you, Glenn, because I think I just called your museum a gallery. Did I do a faux pas by saying that?
Not at all. We answer to all things. We're very happy to be a museum, a gallery, just as long as people find our works of art and programs interesting.
Okay, good enough. I want to have a...
Can I add to that just a little bit?
Yeah, go ahead, Steve.
I'm not going to be precisely contrarian about this, but I do think that Glenn is absolutely right. Part of the draw of the museum now, I think, is as a social experience. And so I wonder about the balance between having a social experience and then having a customizable personal experience. I think that people do flock to museums precisely to share, and share with people they don't necessarily know, that they're not already in communication with. And I think you can see that, come back to a topic we were just discussing, you can see this in the physical shape of these museums themselves. If you look at the floor plans of museums that were built 100 years ago, they didn't include auditoriums.
Oh, you know what, Stephen? I'm going to jump in here. Let me jump in for a second. Because I got pictures here from your book I want to show that help make your point. And then we'll get everybody to comment on this. Let's bring these pictures up here. Here's the first one. Now, this is early 17th century. It's a private gallery of a Flemish collector. And as the picture would suggest, it's plenty busy in there. Now, let's take a look at another picture. And here is the newly renovated Art Gallery of Ontario. And it's not plenty busy there. Now, it looks beautiful. There's a lot of architectural wonder happening in that picture, but it's not plenty busy there. Caitlin, here's the question. Seems as though, and we're sort of returning to something we talked about a little bit earlier, but it seems as though there is almost a reinvigorated accent on making sure that the place in which all of the work is kept is more impressive, or is as impressive, or is almost more important as what's inside it. Do you see that?
I do see it. I have to say I'm very old school, and I don't particularly love it. Maybe I'm terribly old-fashioned. I was just at one of what Steve would call the Beaux-Arts boxes, the Art Institute of Chicago. And what I really appreciated was that I had a classic museum experience of I could sit and I could stare at a painting for as long as I wanted to. I could get up incredibly close, which for me, being a complete art geek, was very exciting to come literally face to face with these extraordinarily famous, well-known images that you'd seen for years in reproduction. So truthfully, I'm not the person who is wildly attracted to this sexy new space. I want to see the objects in this space, and I really want to relate to them. So I'm much more interested in the quality of the lighting, how close I can get, the quality of the text or the explanation. I want a very intimate art experience. And I have to say, my little rant is that I see people racing through. I'm interested in this notion that it's social, because honestly, I'm not sure that it is. It's nice to be surrounded by other people who care, but they're pushing and shoving. They're not looking. They're sort of yammering away on their cell phones, or they're listening to their acoustic guides. But they're not actually really engaging with the material.
Have they got the kids with them? Honestly, it makes a difference if you're schlepping your kids.
It totally does, and I respect that. I'm talking about adults. I'm talking about tourists who say, oh, I went to MoMA, I went to the Art Institute, I went to the ROM. But what did you see? And if you asked 100 of them, but what do you remember? You know, that to me is the question. And I want to spend minutes. I think the average time now is, what, 18? I don't think like it's like a minute and a half is spent even looking at the objects. They just run right through. So I'm sorry, that's a bit of a digression, but that's more my concern is when you're in the space, why are you there? What are you doing there? Are you really enjoying what you're looking at? Are you, the social aspect would be talking about it. And that to me would be interesting. How do you get the conversation going?
Let me hear Janet and Glenn on this as well. Janet, too much accent on the actual physical space right now and in some respects competing with the work inside?
I think context is quite important. And we have to think very carefully about museum spaces because some of those Beaux-Arts boxes that we were talking about a minute ago, they were off-putting for quite a large slice
Absolutely.
Of the community.
Yeah.
And so what I'm interested in is a museum that feels like a welcoming space, mm-hmm. feels like a space that you'd want to be part of. And actually, yeah. that could take a variety of different forms and it's different in different places. But I think then once you're in the space, what you're describing, that aspect of engaging with an object or with a piece of art, again, that's something that we need to help people with. One of the things that we do at the ROM is we have programs for school students, and they start from quite a young age, from 5 or 6, where they handle real objects, and they start to think about objects as things that you can see that they're multifaceted, that there might be different ways of looking at them and getting information from them. That's not a skill that is routinely taught or
Absolutely.
Routinely learnt, yeah. but it's actually one that we all use. And again, I'm not taking for granted that people will continue to do that in the same way, but I think it's something that museums can do. And I think as we all become increasingly digital in our lives, looking at real things is yeah. going to become a joy and a pleasure, but also something that people might need some help with.
Glenn, you want to weigh in on that as well?
I basically agree with Janet. I think in addition to that, I'd say that most museums have a kind of internal strategy, which is to slow people down, yeah. to recognize that we all enter a museum off the street. We kind of come into the museum shot with the energy of the street. Mm-hmm. And once you're in the space of the museum, what you really want to do is create opportunities for people to decelerate so that they can concentrate and look and find works of art and projects that are surprising and that require some thinking in order to truly understand. But I think everyone moves through these spaces in a different way. Some people come alone with a decided interest in one object. Other people come with a friend or a child or a spouse, and they're there to sort of share a very common experience. And yet other people come and engage with strangers and find that exciting, and that none of these are mutually exclusive. But within the space of the museum, through lighting, through additional information, through the pacing of an installation, the relationship of one work to another, what you really want to do is create the opportunity for people to think and learn on their own. And, you know, I'm not that worried that sometimes people go rushing by a group of objects only to slow down in front of a different set, because I do think people locate themselves in a museum to their sort of pace, and not everyone is interested in the same things when they come into an institution.
I want to get your feedback then, everybody, on, and this speaks to what you were just referring to a moment ago. I went to MoMA, I went to Guggenheim, I covered the bases, I saw them all.
Right.
If you go to Google, they've got a website that allows you to explore 17 museums and art galleries. We're going to show a snippet of this, and then we're going to come back and chat. Michael, roll tape, please.
Google claims that the level of detail that the gigapixel images allows is greater than that capable by the human eye. In this piece, The Chumley Ladies, you can zoom into the billions of pixels and see the paintbrush strokes and even the detail of the eye color. Some may say, why go to the museum when you can see art from the comfort of your own home?
Well, they asked the question, Steve, as well about sporting events. You know, why go to see the Buckeyes play when you can see them better at home in Sensoround or on HDTV? What's the answer here? Why go to a museum where you can see it better and at your own pace in your own living room?
Yeah, I'm not buying that. Because you're quite right. We've had variations of this concern really across the whole 20th century. When people started pressing vinyl records, people were convinced nobody would go hear live music anymore. That didn't happen. I think that there are a whole host of reasons why people will still go. I do think, in fact, that I don't know how we'd measure this exactly, but that these online and virtual experiences may actually wind up being a big boon to a lot of museums because it will encourage people to go to these places who otherwise might not, or go to look for specific things that they might otherwise not have known about. The technology that makes it possible for me to see something I couldn't see with my naked eye actually makes my head spin, and I don't even want to get into that necessarily. But I do think that, as somebody else pointed out earlier, the experience of being in front of something authentic, the real thing, I think is going to matter, and I'm not convinced that the digital world is ever going to displace that.
Okay, here's where I say yes, but Jay, if your 10 city-owned galleries are having a problem breaking through, is this a potential marketing device for you?
I think it is. I think that virtual world can drive traffic to the physical spaces. And so I think it's very important from almost a marketing perspective, a tourism perspective, and for local residents to experience it online. I mean, let's face it, it's the way of the world for younger audiences particularly. And that's one of my objectives, is to try to get younger people involved and using mediums like social media that are so popular right now. I mean, this is the way, this is the direction we're moving in, and we have to move with it. So I do think there's a real asset there in finding ways to drive people to the physical spaces through the virtual world.
Janet, would you be concerned that if somebody could go online for free and see everything they want to in your museum, that they wouldn't need to buy a ticket and go to your museum?
Well, you know, we used to worry about this terribly back in the 1990s when the internet first appeared. We all fretted that nobody would come to museums anymore, and it didn't happen. And I think it's the same with this this technology. If anything, I think it's going to help people who perhaps haven't been to a museum or haven't been to a gallery to feel more comfortable moving around that kind of space. And I think it's going to function as a new shop window for us. Increasingly, my worry is the opposite. If we're not in the online space, then we're becoming increasingly invisible. When everybody books their holiday and chooses where they're going to go online, if we're not in that space, we're going to be seen as invisible and irrelevant.
Caitlin, what's your view on that?
I think it's really interesting. One of the things that I really treasure about museums, the ROM, and all the museums I've been to, and we haven't really talked about this, is that you can literally time travel. And I find this extraordinary, that literally by crossing the hallway, you can cross millennia. And I find this really magical and really extraordinary. So that I was at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. There's a pair of earrings I really want, and they're Roman, so I can't have them. And they're literally the size of my thumb, and they're the most exquisite objects. As a lady who likes jewelry, I love these earrings. But then I cross the hallway, and I can look at Impressionist art, and I can cross another hallway, and I can look at sculpture from Crete from, you know, a thousand years ago. So I love this notion, and I think this is the great power and strength of the historical museums and the great galleries, is you can literally go from one period to the next, and if you really love a certain color, a certain design, I'm crazy about textiles, you can literally sort of follow the thread. You can spend an entire day in a museum going from one century, one country, one culture. That, to me, there's an extraordinary richness and layering the online experience doesn't give you. It brings you in, which is great, but once you're there, you can go, oh my lord, I saw a totem pole, and I saw something in the Japanese gallery, and it looks sort of similar. You know, the whole notion of the linkages, which I don't think you can get unless you start to see them in relationship to each other.
Steve, could I leap in there? Because I think that's absolutely right. And then I think there's another aspect. Those people who are hugely interested in a particular collection, and let's take textiles for an example, you can do things online that actually you can't do in the physical space. So our textile collection is wonderful, but most of it you can't display for more than 3 months at a time. It's very fragile because light destroys the atoms. Everybody's clothes get old. We have to make sure that these textiles don't ever get old. And it's very hard to do. But online, there are now communities across the whole world who are engaging with textile collections, using them as inspiration for new pieces of art and craft that they're making in a way that wasn't possible before. So as well as that time travel, you can also go deep into a collection, and we're seeing that more and more.
Steve, go ahead.
And I would add to that, and I'm sure that Janet knows a lot more about this than I do, but I think that for some of the large museums, and especially those that are unable to display even a large percentage of what they own, there's almost an aspect of social responsibility in being able to at least put these objects online, that there isn't a physical space, or perhaps the material can't be exhibited in front of an audience, that now this is stuff that is from the basements accessible in a way that it wasn't ever before. And I do think if museums are going to be seen as trustworthy repositories of our shared culture, then they do have an obligation to get this stuff out to us, and the virtual world may be the best way to do that.
Okay, fair enough, but let me try this up with Glenn. Glenn, what if somebody says Melted Clocks by Salvador Dali? Have you seen it? And the guy goes, oh yeah, sure, I've seen it. I saw it online the other day. Well, they haven't really seen it, have they?
Of course they haven't really seen it, but they've seen an image of it, and maybe that image of it has struck them as something worthwhile pursuing the next time they're in New York, and they get to see The Persistence of Memory, Dali's great painting. But the reality for me is that it's a false distinction, because I think what we're going to see over the next decade is the collapsing of the difference between the real and the virtual. Virtual space, of course, can't exist without real space, so we don't have to worry about that anxiety at the end of the day. But what we can think about is how what the virtual world enables and what happens in real space can come together so that they are increasingly seamless, so that that access to information that Janet was talking about that would otherwise be hidden within the museum can in fact be something you can access either while you're at the museum or while you're traveling elsewhere, and that these worlds need not exist in some apposition to each other, but can be mutually reinforcing. And I think we're headed in that direction. I find that very exciting, because the amount of knowledge and information embedded in any given work of art or in any one of our collections is so much greater than what we can easily make evident in the course of an exhibition, that any strategy that allows us to develop a deeper, more profound, and at times broader engagement with objects is a strategy that is beneficial to what we do.
I am curious though, Glenn, do you think you speak for the majority of museum directors when you put that forward? Because my completely unscientific hunch would be there are many people who would see it the exact opposite way, and that this is a sign that the apocalypse is upon us.
I think that may have been how people felt 10, 15, 20 years ago, but I don't think there are very many museum directors, certainly not very many art museum directors today, who are afraid of the virtual. I think most of us are looking at ways to harness the ideas and the possibilities behind digital and online technologies in order to amplify what we do.
Okay, and can I also say, this is why he does what he does and I do what I do. He called it The Persistence of Memory, which is of course the correct title of the painting, and I called it That Thing with the Melted Clocks, which shows that I'm never going to be a curator of a great art gallery anytime soon. Thank you for the correcting the record there, Mr. Lowry.
You need to get to that museum more regularly.
Yes, I think that's right. Touche, touche. All right, let's try.
Can I just add one more thing?
Yeah, please.
One more piece to that equation, because it is an interesting issue, which is that it touches to something that I think Janet may have mentioned, or Stephen, that we have this hunger for the authentic. We actually want to see, touch, feel, know that we have been in the presence of something real. So the notion that somehow the virtual will replace in totality the real is just a false anxiety. I think the opposite happens, that when we learn about something, we want to go and see it, we want to go and hear it, we want to go and experience it, because that's the only way we can locate ourselves in relationship to that object in space.
Okay, let me put a somewhat controversial issue on the table here, and Janet, I'm going to go to you first. There are, in this city, at least three, but certainly three significant provincially owned institutions of culture. You've got one of them, the Royal Ontario Museum. There's the Art Gallery of Ontario, and there's the Ontario Science Centre as well. In your really candid moments with yourself, do you say to yourself, mine's the best?
Of course. But then...
But is it true?
Well, no, but... Of course, I love the ROM. I've been there for 15 months and I've fallen in love with it, and of course I have to think that it's wonderful.
But is there an objective truth as to which one of these, say three, pick 25, doesn't matter? Within the community, you must all have a pecking order, right? And I want to know what it is.
And that's where I, all joking aside, that's where I part company. It seems to me that there is no point in seeing ourselves as being in competition with each other. We all have the same job, and that's actually to make Toronto and Ontario and the GTA a fantastic place to live and to experience culture.
But you are in competition.
No. We're really not. We're really not.
How can you say that? You're in competition not only with the Art Gallery of Ontario, you're in competition with the Toronto Maple Leafs, and with the movie playing down the street, and with a thousand other things.
One of the things that I think comes from looking at museums in economic terms is sometimes we're seen as being in competition. There's an ecosystem out there, and in that ecosystem, there's room for museums, there's room for galleries, there's room for the maple leaves, there's room for all of these different activities. And when we're all doing what we're doing right, then Toronto and Ontario is fabulous. It's a place that people want to come and live and work and be part of, and they want to come and visit here. And so in that sense, we all have the job of investing in the next generation of people who go to museums. We all have the job of encouraging an appreciation of art. We all have the job, I think, of really seeing ourselves as civic citizens in this area. And so, yes, we have financial targets that we need to reach, but I don't mind if somebody comes and has a great time at the ROM and then says, next time I'm going to go to the AGO.
How about this, Kate? In terms of authority, is there a pecking order of who can say we're number one?
I have to tell you, I'm disagreeing with you respectfully, and I'm going to agree with Janet.
Oh, you guys
are
no fun.
Sorry, you know, that's what you get for inviting a bunch of smart women. But, you know, and
I'll agree with you.
Thank you. I may not be typical of tourists because I'm from Toronto originally, but when I come back, and I'm back to Toronto a lot, I have family and friends, I go to a Blue Jays game, I go to the AGO. It's not either or, and I think it's really important to not create this false dichotomy, which I think does happen. The notion is, oh, museums are elitist, art galleries are elitist, oh, I can't relate to art. Of course you can. That's part of what a fully rounded human being does. You can go play hockey in the morning, and you can go look at some fabulous paintings at the AGO, or some wonderful totem poles, or Japanese art. I mean, the ROM is such a treasure house. I don't think, yes, you're competing for dollars, I get that in that sense, but I think we need a larger sense with our kids as you raise them up to say, you can be a jock and you can love painting, you can love sculpture and you can be a musician. We're not just one kind of person.
Absolutely, and that's in fact, my namesake in Ohio is going to agree with me on this one. Go ahead, Steve, come on in here.
I do think there are all kinds of ways we could measure that the art gallery as such, the art museum, sits at the top of what, let's call it, a cultural hierarchy. And the easiest way to measure that, I think, is to look at the audience. And I'm not talking about numbers here, but art galleries, art museums, the MoMA, the Metropolitan, the Art Institute of Chicago, are places for grown-ups. And children get brought there. Science museums, go down Michigan Avenue to the Museum of Science and Industry in Chicago, that's a place for kids. The decibel level goes way up. The frenetic activity goes way up. That's a place to go for fun. And in that sense, I think there is these art museums, by and large, command more authority in that sense. They get to build the bigger additions, the flashier new buildings. I think if you were to look at endowments of art museums, the big ones as compared to the endowments of science museums, you'd see a pretty dramatic difference.
I want to hear from Glenn Lowry. Caitlin, you sit tight for a second, because I know you want to come back at that. But I cannot believe in a million years Glenn Lowry doesn't think to himself, and he'll correct me if I'm wrong here, but I don't think I am, I sit atop, in terms of authority, the preeminent museum of its kind in the world. And he wouldn't for a second think I can compete in the authority space with a science museum or an artifacts museum. Okay, Mr. Lowry, over to you.
Well, I guess I come in somewhere in between here. First of all, having been the director of the Art Gallery of Ontario, I'm very partial to the AGO. It's a wonderful place. But I don't actually think the AGO and the ROM, for instance, and the Science Center compete in an arena where one is on top of the other, although they compete individually in their own spaces. And unlike Janet, I do think we compete for people's time. We are collectively in the leisure world. Even though what we have to offer may be educational, we compete with people's time. Will they go shopping? Will they walk in the park? Will they go to a symphony? Will they play the hockey game? Will they visit the AGO? Will they come to the Museum of Modern Art? Will they go to the ROM? Those are discrete decisions, and they're not going to do all of those things. So we are in an environment in which we are competing not only for people's time, we're also competing for objects, we're competing for financial support, we're competing for trustees, and we're competing for attention. But that doesn't mean we don't work together. That doesn't mean we don't exist in a community that's mutually reinforcing, that sure recognizes that some people will enjoy what we do more than what somebody else does, and vice versa. Those of us who are privileged to work in institutions that have established over decades a kind of preeminence for the quality of their collections and their impact in their world, obviously spend a lot of time thinking about how to ensure that we continue to play a major role. And you have to be aware of what other people are doing in that context and ensure that your programs, your projects, your collection, your audience remains as engaged and as preeminent as possible. So I'm very attuned to the notion that we live in a competitive environment, but I'm equally sensitive to the fact that in that environment, we don't play out competition the way two sports teams may play it out. One has to win, one has to lose, because I don't think it's about winning and losing.
No, fair enough. I understand.
I think it's about striving to be the best.
Let me go to Jay on this, though. My hunch is when you go over the books at City Hall, you do say, this museum is more worthy of our support than this one is. You have a hierarchy there, I presume, don't you?
Yeah, so during this budget cycle, we did have to look at all the museums and who was underperforming and the number of people going through the door. And unfortunately, sometimes it comes down to that quantitative approach. I don't particularly agree with that approach. I think these sites are very important to the culture of the city.
But they're not all created equal.
But they aren't. But I think we need to think of them in a collaborative way. Years ago, we launched a campaign called Live with Culture, and that was the birthplace of Nuit Blanche, which I produced the first 3 years. And the genesis of that was in Paris. But what we did is we Torontoized it, and we brought all the institutions together, all the art galleries, and as well, all sorts of curators who created new installations. And so I think that working together is critical for this city and all cities across North America in order to survive.
Nuit Blanche is doing really well now, isn't it?
Very well.
Tens of thousands of people participate,
yes.
If not
well,
more.
Well, year one, we almost had 1 million people. I mean, the streets were filled, yeah. And people just seemed to be hungry for that event. It's like we were waiting for that event to come to Toronto.
Okay, Caitlin, you wanted to go back at Steve on his suggestion.
I did. I'm sorry, and thanks for letting me jump in. You know, I'm going to just be provocative, and I don't have children, so I'm no expert. However, I think I don't understand these divisions between the science museum, the history museum, the art museum, the art gallery. It's all terrific stuff, and we can learn from it. So maybe I'm unusual, and I probably am. I was taken to the Tate Gallery. We lived in London when I was a little girl. I was taken to the Tate when I was 3, 4, and 5. And, you know, kids don't de facto have to run around and break things and smash things. They can really enjoy being in a space, could be sculpture, might not be a painting, might be something more three-dimensional. But this notion that science museums are for noisy, crazy kids and art galleries are for quiet contemplation for adults only, I think is not that extreme.
No, but would you acknowledge there's a hierarchy within the cultural world that says the Art Gallery of Ontario is a more serious, more...
Honestly,
than the Science Center is.
But honestly, I think that's madness. Because if you look, I really do. I mean, I think in a very multidisciplinary way as a writer and as a thinker. And I think, you know, we can't get women into science and mathematics. We have a problem with STEM, the whole technology engineering disciplines. We can't get women in. If you take little girls to a science museum, maybe they're more interested. Maybe we want to take them to all sorts of places so they're understanding. I truly don't think there is a hierarchy because science is absolutely crucial to our culture and art is crucial to our culture. And I don't think ranking them is helpful really to anybody.
Okay, let me get Steve in for a response and then Janet.
Sure. Well, what I really mean is in some ways in the opposite direction. It's not that kids don't have a great time in art museums. I certainly have dragged my two kids to art museums all the time, and we do different things there than adults might do. But it is the case, certainly in the United States, and if you talk to any science museum director, depending on how candid they really want to be, what they'll acknowledge is that the educational level that's pitched here is at about 12 years old. So the art museum isn't necessarily simply for adults, but it does seem to be the case that what's put on display at science museums is targeted at children and the adults who bring them. And I think that's, you know, that has its own history. It wasn't always like that, but I do think it is the case. And I think there are real problems with this as well, because I think what it has contributed to is a general scientific illiteracy Absolutely. On the part of all of us grown-ups who kind of fell asleep during physics class. But I think that's what it's come down to. As I said, I'll pick on the Museum of Science and Industry in Chicago, which outside the Smithsonian in the United States is the single most visited museum in the country. And 3/4 of the people who come there are under the age of 15.
Interesting. Jen.
I just wanted to respond to what Glenn said. I think really there is a competition for people's time, but there's not a competition between the different organizations in how that works. And so how do I deal with the fact that there are new technologies that are coming along that perhaps look more interesting than coming to a museum on a Saturday afternoon? I do that by looking and constantly making sure that we're there as an option for people to consider, and also that we're adapting, to the way that people like to learn and the way that they like to spend their time. And so that's where I think we deal with the competition for attention. In terms of this aspect about children and adults, I used to work in a science museum, and now I work in a museum that has natural history components and has collections from all over the world. What I've seen for many years is in the research, which is that it's great to catch people young, and libraries are doing this increasingly now, mm-hmm. is that if children are welcomed into these spaces and they have a great time, then they become museum visitors, they become gallery goers. And actually, I think it's beholden on all of us to make sure that some of the preconceptions that I've actually never seen in my career, you know, I've never seen a notice up in the museum saying that you have to be quiet. And yet, it's one of the misconceptions that people have about museums. You know, it's for instance part of the things that we need to do to make sure people feel comfortable in these spaces. And then there's that third dynamic. One of the things about families coming to museums and galleries is that quite often, and I've done this myself when I've gone to museums with kids, is that you make the visit all about the kids. And you take a step back and you don't engage yourself because you're doing it for the children. And one of the things that we're increasingly doing is trying to find ways that parents and children can do things together, because that's one of the most powerful things. And even at the ROM, for instance, we've just introduced a membership ticket where grandparents can bring their grandchildren, because that's one of the new areas of growth. People are now coming out with their grandchildren and they're all doing things together. And I think that that's a great way, again, of passing on this awareness and this comfort in museum and gallery spaces.
Let me ask, I got about a minute and a half to go here, and Glenn Lowry, I want to ask you this last question. We love elitism in some circles. We want the most elite athletes playing for our hockey teams or our football teams. We want the most elite professors teaching our kids at university. There is a discomfort, though, when elitism is used in the same sentence as museums or art galleries or whatever. Do we have to get over that?
Well, I think we have to be very clear by what we mean when we use elitism. I think if we use elitism to describe social status, then I think we don't want a condition in which social status precludes anyone from enjoying what's going on in a museum. But if we use elitism as a means of describing the quest for the best, we want to go to those institutions whose programs are the best, whose collections are the best, whose engagement with the public is going to be the most intense. So I'm not so troubled by people thinking of museums as elite when they think of them as places where great things happen, where you can encounter genius, where you can encounter works of art that are transformative. But I am troubled by it when it implies that there are either written or unwritten, practiced or unpracticed, things happening there that preclude people from feeling comfortable. Janet used the word welcoming, and I think the central aspect of everything we try to do at the Museum of Modern Art is to create a place where anyone from any walk of life and anywhere in the world feels immediately welcomed into the space and into the programs of the institution, but where they are going to encounter the most elite, the most undemocratic of all things there could be, and that is artistic talent. That is not distributed equally across the population, but to engage directly with an extraordinary work of art is a remarkable experience, and that's what we're about.
We are very happy here at TVO to have welcomed the five of you to our space and our program, and we're glad you could all participate. Let me thank our out-of-town guests first. Stephen Conn in Columbus, Ohio, Glenn Lowry from MoMA in New York. Great pleasure having you two on the line. Then here in the studio, Janet Carding, the director and CEO of the Royal Ontario Museum, Jay Robinson, city councillor, Ward 25, Don Valley West here in Toronto, Caitlin Kelly, the freelance journalist and author on the other side of the table. Great discussion, everyone. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at tvo.org.